So the idea was to talk about the regional hypothermia as a targeted approach. So you're targeting the tumor deep in the body, but it could be also extremity lesions. And the model of sarcoma is interesting because sarcomas, soft tissue sarcomas, arise everywhere in the body. So it was in the early 96 or 97 when we decided to do this trial, it was interesting to have all the high-risk tumors all over the body distributed. The only one we could not treat at the time was, of course, lung tumors. And the you see also here, I want to make this remark, with 40 to 43 degree. The reason why I made this is not, we never can have a homogeneous temperature profile in the tumor. We always have areas with 43 and more, which are the necrotic areas in the tumor by this approach. And then you have other areas of the tumor which are low, like 37 degree. And we have measured about 1,000 or more than 5,000 in the sarcoma business, tumors with invasive thermometry. And we always have the same heterogeneous temperature profile. So this is also a fundamental information. If you use this kind of technology, you will see in a moment, you always have this range between 40 to 43. We cannot define and say homogeneous elevation of temperature. And you see also that we give it the chemotherapy simultaneously. This is also a difference from radiation, because if you ask the audience, 50% will vote, we want to give the radiation before hypothermia, and the other 50% reward, we give it vice versa. And for both, I'm not going in detail, there are strong rationales. So this is different also from chemotherapy, because you always give the chemotherapy at the same time. Now this is of course the old picture. There's a mistake, it's not 3D, it was the Sigma 60 at this time. And most what I'm presenting is interestingly, I should say, based on the technology which was used in 96 to 2006, so in this area. So we did not use any hybrid, we did not use the Sigma I, we used the simple one, even the Yapas was the first patient drill. Now, keep in mind that, come to this point in a moment, but you should know what I said initially, that the temperature-dependent cellular molecular events was already here summarized in 2008, were known from many, many other laboratories and investigators, shown that you have a very precise molecular mechanism in terms of heat shock protein induction. And interestingly, we read and talk a lot about fever-like hypothermia. But you should keep in mind that in tumor cells, in the range of 40, at least 41, you're increasing the synthesis of this HSP 70, for instance, as a marker protein. And we know that this HSP 70 induction has some function. As soon as this HSP 70 protein is released outside of the cell, inside it makes cells resistant, has something to do with thermotolerance and so on. But as soon as you have a necrotic area and the HSP are released, then you have, of course, an immunological fundamental function, at least from preclinical work. I will mention this in a moment. And also keep in mind, this is the effect of heat alone. You kill cells as soon as you are above 42.5, you have the heat effect by its own. By the other one is not efficient. If you give ifosfamide at 37 degrees in a special drug amount to the patient, you can have a lock or two lock killing effect, which is not toxic at 37. If you give it at 41 or 42. So there is a lot of chemosensitization. We know this all over the years. And I tell you what is new. The second one was, it's also already well known, and it's summarized from Elfriede Nössner from my group in the 2011. This again takes together at least 10 publications on the different aspects of HSP immunology. But what I want to give you the message here is that you have the tumor and you give hypothermia, as soon as you have this necrotic area or the necrotic effect of heat on cells, you have induced the HSP70, which is here the marker inducer protein, heat shock protein, and this goes outside of the cell. So you release this HSP70. And we have all, several groups, shown that the HSP70 bursts inside or takes as a chaperone the peptide complex or the peptide antigens of these tumors, which is very interesting. It's very personalized medicine. Yeah? You have your own antigens, the tumor antigens are chaperoned by this HSP70. And then in the next step, there are two interesting directions. One is mainly shown by Gabi Multov from my group, that this HSP70 complexes or HSP70 is lead to an activation of natural killer cells. This has been shown again preclinically in a lot of investigations. And confirmed is what we have done in Munich, in my group, separate from Multov, was that we cross-present this peptide bound to HSP70 in so-called dendritic cells, which are antigen-presenting cells, and they can present these peptides now much more easily to T cells. So we call this an adaptive immune response, because you have now created a T cell activation which goes against the tumor, and this is adaptive, and this is the so-called innate immune system. So you have both directions are activated. And keep in mind, all what I said have never been proven in clinics. It's only a preclinical work. What we need is now to expand this to the clinical situation. Now, most recently, and that's what I said is new, is again just a review, comes out in February. What I'm saying and what we did here with Roland Kanaar from the Dutch group and myself and Lars Lindner, his leader in Munich, we summarized, in fact, all the data who were created, and we called in the context of hypothermia, from all the preclinical models. And a little bit like Hanahan and Weinberg said, hallmarks, we used the same word and the same context for hypothermia, which is provocative, of course. But interestingly enough, we were able, with the help of Mark Dewhurst, to define six essential effects of heat in tumor cells. And these are all summarized here in this paper. And it's not going in detail, but it's more or less informing the people what's going on with hypothermia as soon as you give it in the clinic. And beside this very well-known sensitization to radiation and or chemotherapy, more important is, as I said before, in high temperature dependent way, dose dependent, you kill any cell, any tumor cell, there's no one defined which is completely heat resistant. You're inducing the cellular stress response by heat shock proteins, which creates then the immune system, but it has also other effects as well. And you see here, modulating immune response, I gave you just a little cartoon how to explain this. And evading DNA repair is maybe the most important part, because we know this over the last 6 to 8 years already. One, again, from the Kanaar's group, that BRCA2 is induced by heat, which is very important. And it was a couple of years ago before already shown in an oncogene publication that BRCA1, which is the other very important repair system, a protein in this homologous repair system, is also blocked. So we have a machinery evading DNR repair, which is so convincing that some people, at least in my audience, they are being aware now of hypothermia, because we have the mechanism more clearly defined. And the last one is the microenvironment, which is maybe the most important part. When I see Betsy Wiparski or Sean Evans showing this kind of immune response, but more in the tumor microenvironment that you create an atmosphere, I would say a milieu by heat, that the cells go to the tumor and go maybe inside the tumor by IL-6 dependent mechanism, very well and interestingly shown by this group. So the whole picture becomes very complete. And it's nice that this kind of effects you should keep in mind whenever you use heat in the context of chemotherapy or radiation. Now what I'm doing is here, I give you an update. I cannot go the sarcoma trials over the last 25 years. Or what I'm saying this with this is, it's a 25-year experience and we know exactly what we're doing because we joined the soft tissue bone sarcoma group in Munich from the ERTC and we are all in the CTOS members, which is the Connective Tissue Oncology Society worldwide. So we are in the panel of ESMO, and this is the European Society of Medical Oncology, we make the guidelines. So what I'm saying here again is, you should be an expert in the tumor entity which you are advertising that hyperthermia helps. You should not go in this audience and say it's important. Rüdiger is an expert in non-testicular germ cell tumors, and his father, his mentor, was one of the leader on these tumors in Düsseldorf and had the study in whole Germany. So it's a little background always behind the information, and therefore he's so good. Yeah? So what we do here is, when we had 2008-10 was a great time. We had several reports now that hyperthermia adds to chemotherapy. We had an invitation to give a current opinion oncology review, and we published the Lancet Oncology paper, which most of you know. And at this time, I must say, the primary endpoint was reached, and the local progression-free survival and disease-free survival was positive, but there was absolutely no effect on overall survival. And the follow-up was 33 or 34 months. The principle, what we do is, we define the highest risk group in this adult soft tissue sarcoma, which is greater 5 centimeter, grade 2 or 3, depending on the mitotic index in these tumors. And of course, they must be deep, so superficial tumors are not a risk for the patients. But if you have all these three parameters all together, you have defined from the heterogeneous population a very defined, clear, high risk homogeneous population. So this is interesting. And what we also do, as we do as in children, we give an induction chemotherapy, we give a best surgery, we give radiation, in this case post-operative, and then we give post-induction chemotherapy. But what we did in our trial, and all the trials over the last years, we combined always this kind of approach with heat. Now, this is just to give you the summary. Each of these steps were published, and this was started in 86 when we started the trial, 90 was published, the first publication on second-line chemotherapy and hyperthermia. What we learned from all this stepwise was, finally we had primary tumors. Yeah? This is the phase 3 trial, Lancet Oncology, 341 patients. What the summary is, that hyperthermia kills tumor cells as temperatures 40 to 43 degrees. This we know from the preclinical work. Phase 2 studies showed favorable disease control rates for high-risk soft tissue sarcoma when chemotherapy was combined with regional hyperthermia. Okay. Toxicity was low. This is a very short sentence, but this is the most important one, that the patient has no harm. And you can deliver the heat in this context of this trial for this heavily pre-treated patient in some cases without any harm to the patient. And local progression-free survival, this is important, is an adequate endpoint. Now, this was the publication, and I said, multicenter trial, open label, because you cannot blind label the hyperthermia. And the US was also represented by Serko Oskarovich, you see it here, at the time when he was in Duke, and many other centers, of course. And the good thing was, it was a center trial which the ERTC, soft tissue sarcoma group, as well as the ESHO. So we had both societies on board. And this was the primary endpoint, and you see here, positive, positive, I should say, overall survival at 34 months, median follow-up negative. So this is kind of, you see, when we were discussing this, there was an editorial in the Lancet Oncology, said it's nice. I talked to Lex Eggermont, he said it's nice, good results, primary endpoint proven, so it's a positive trial, but it's a pity that you don't have any overall survival. Yeah? So I'm going now to show you after the Vienna meeting on ECHO, where we presented this as a late-breaking abstract, the most recent results and follow-up update from the sarcoma trial, 304 patients randomized, 300, if you put them together, 329 analyzed. So you should say randomized is analyzed, intention to treat, but 7 patients never received this intervention and 5 patients never received this intervention. So we put every patient on the outcome and the evaluation. So these you see, as I said before, 329 patients. You see the randomization. Response was already published in the first paper and in the surgical assessment. But most important now, you see simple, very parallel and similar numbers in resection. So it's not a difference in resection. And we have the full manuscript is ready to go. And I can tell you the amputation rate is less than 5% in both arms. So we are radiation, radiotherapy, 105 to 105, we are lucky. It was not stratified, of course, because it's an intervention, but it was completely similar, yeah, and identical in this case. And then we looked, of course, now overall survival. And I go quickly over this, I don't go in detail, but you see what the major message from this is, that we have, in contrast to all the other negative trials of the ATC, we have a retroperitoneal abdominal tumor site more than the extremity lesion, which is covered in all the other published results. So we are one which has the highest number and percentage of the most unfavorable prognostic soft tissue sarcoma, which is pelvic, and as I said before, and the upper part of the proximity lesions in the extremity. So we are definitely not have chosen the low risk. We have done the high-risk group, even by sight. And you see also 50% in both, we never expected this, came to us as primary tumors. We had about 10% in both arms as recurrent. And then we have, attempt was made by another 40% in both arms to resect it, but it was impossible. So again, a sign that, of course, for such a study, you get the patient who are the worst ones. Yeah? Now, this is now important. You have over 12 centimeter, a third in both arms, and you see grading is very important. This is the most important risk factor in soft tissue sarcoma. Grading was completely equal, and also the size was equal, and then you see all the different pathologies. Most important message is it was reviewed by the EOTC pathologists. So you are not doing a trial which has some soft tissue sarcoma not identified. You have in the both arms the same, as you see the numbers, same group of these tumors. Now what is now important is not the overall response which was already published. It's more than doubled in comparison. So this is the hyperthermia, neoadjuvant chemo plus regional hyperthermia arm has to read. And this is the chemo control arm. So you're doubling the response. What I mean is objective response. I'm not talking about shrinking of tumor, I'm talking about more than 50% reduction or complete response. And you see here, this is the doubling. And again, this response was 96% of these images were reviewed by the EOTC, which is again important, in the independent review committee. And p-value, of course, highly significant, but keep this line, this is most important. During the way you give the, during the time you give the neoadjuvant, the preoperative chemo, the failure rate is 7.2%, because this takes 3 months. You have a tumor on the extremity and the pelvic, you give a neoadjuvant chemo. We have, of course, patients who are not responding. This is 7.2% out of this group. But look at the other arm. In the chemo alone, you have 21.6% which are progressive. So the first indication there is something in addition to response is prevent of progression, locally or distance. And this, again, was compared in the first paper with the other approaches, like EOTC Gottsack is a neoadjuvant chemo trial, 18% early progression, 7.2 in our trial. MD Anderson, Pistas, neoadjuvant chemo, 30%. The second series, 26%. RTOG, radio chemo therapy preoperative with high dose chemo and the MATE, we call it Mayday regimen there because it's so toxic. 14%. So you are better, but you are not 7.2%. And we have a trial which is not toxic to the patient. Now, we had, of course, to now after 12 years median follow-up, we have to look, of course, to our first endpoint of the study. And you see here, dramatic. It's the percentage is giving here, but more important is the p-value, 0.012, and the hazard ratio. So from you have a 29% reduction of the risk of local progression if you give heat in addition to all the other three modalities. If you compare this with other trials from the medical oncology audience, you can live with this and you are superior to the advantages in terms of 3 or 4 or 5 months. Because if you look the median, this is the median line. You have here 3 years and here you have 6 years, something like this. So that means you are doubling the local progression. Now, if you look in disease-free survival, again, we had to do this after no more 34 months. Now we do it under 124 months. So now you have 10 years follow-up, and you see it's becoming even more disease-free survival. That means local or distance. Yeah? Still, it's not overall survival. And you see here a clear benefit, and it's in the terms of the log rank, is 72. So we have a 28% reduction to have any event local or distant. Now comes, of course, the new data, and this will be published soon. We have now a clear benefit, and interestingly, most interestingly, in contrast to all other trials, after the initial observation time, the two curves were more or less crossing. Yeah? But interestingly, in contrast to other trials which have not an immune modulator on it, we see that the separation of these two curves now occurs after 24 or 30 months. And if you look in the literature and discuss these results with anybody of the medical oncology, they said, Rolf, you have to use a checkpoint inhibitor, or you have to modulate an immune response. You cannot explain the data that the lines go separate after the treatment about 2 years later. This is very unusual. You have to have an immune effect. So this is the most likely effect we have, and we have some data on it. Now, what we, of course, looked carefully was now, what is the clinical benefit? If you show median survival double, is nice, but what happens really at the different, I'm not going in local and disease-free survival, look at here. This is the important part. This is completely new. We have even in the hypothermia 77 deaths occurred. And 97 occurred now. It was originally in the first publication identical numbers. Now we have, looks a small number, but it's important for the trial. 20 deaths different. And you see here the significance of the p-value. But now more important is, the median duration of survival is 15.4 years in the combined arm and 6.2 years in the control arm. So you're doubling the overall survival, median survival. But now look at 2 years, at 5 years and 9 years. The difference is always about 15-13%. So what you can give the message to the audience outside the public, we have now shown in a model tumor where we have the highest risk is gone. Yeah? It's much more difficult. Now this is the current protocol. This is four times the Adriamycin ifosfamide regimen. We give surgery with pre- and post-radiotherapy, and then four cycles after. And this is the example. As he said, also he showed you some example. You always want to look beside all the numbers. You want to see a type of person, how they benefit. You see here, this was a 35 years male with a desmoplastic small onset tumor, which is very hard to treat by chemo alone, pelvis. You see, first diagnosis came, gets four times the IR regimen, PR, favorable histological response, so more than 75% was necrotic. He gets another one, and he is now alive 5 years, and this is the tumor. So you see that we are not dealing with small size tumors. The tumor was before therapy, was 2011, and then after three cycles, Adriamycin ifosfamide, you see this already, the response and the results is given here. Now the other case is Moscow. This was, no, this is the lower extremity, upper part. You see here the scan, the CT scan, and you see here the situation, how it is. And this was the patient from Moscow. He came with a first cycle of Adriamycin and was progressive, it gets more pain, and then we treated further with our regimen, and you see the size, and he is now alive at this time. I tried to get the follow-up for 2016, but we were not able to reach him, but he was at this time alive for 24 months. Now, and more important is this one. You see the alveolar soft pars sarcoma with vital tumor cells before, and this is at the time of resection, you have a PCR. So again, I'm saying you have endpoints, which is the histological endpoint, you have a radiological endpoint, you have the endpoint of progression-free survival, and of course different endpoints, and use these endpoints because this is convincing for the outside. And another case is this, I make the story short now. So you see here the PET scan showing this large activation, and then here, and here is the tumor, and here is the outcome. So the conclusion, sorry, I did a little bit longer, the more than 50 minutes. So the four patients with local advanced soft tissue sarcoma, we saw all the response rate, the progression-free survival, disease-free survival, and now the results also translate in overall survival. And we get the information now, as soon as this paper comes out, we will in the ESMO guidelines no more state this is a treatment option. We will state, since this is overall survival, is a 1A or B, definitely one evidence of medicine, and we get already the ESMO response that will be included with a 1B recommendation, and again B, not because the study is not confirmed, because we have only a few centers. So, and the argument is we cannot, from Europe, send all the patients with high risk of tissue comas to Munich, which is acceptable. So we are running again in the same situation as the pediatric oncologist. I thank you very much for your attention, and thank you. Very important, and what I can tell you, because it's officially presented, is in the last October meeting in the Onc Immunological Symposium of the ESMO, we presented a discussion poster where we looked in the trial, which I presented right now, in 140 biopsies of the tumor before and after, non-paired, keep this in mind. If we would have paired samples, all from all the patients before and after, no. One-third was paired, two-thirds was not paired. And this is important because you must be very careful to make statements which you finally cannot hold on. But the results show that the TILs, the tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes, and this is most important for Betsy Pasky and so, is going by hypothermia much higher than in the other arm. So we are not meeting the significance, but we meet now the following. It seems to be that the low tilts population have a worse prognosis, and by hypothermia they become high tilts. This is something which I can tell you. But we are present at present. We look for CD3, PD-L1, PD-1, and for CD4, CD8, and NK cells. And this week we get the 3 days ago the acceptance of immune oncol that in our high risk population the NK cell activity is 20% down. But we have not included in the publication, which is accepted, is in press now, and it's not. We have not included the increase by hypothermia. We look carefully now if in these patients the NK cell activity will be increased, and this was done in the peripheral blood, so it's easy to do it immediately. So, unfortunately, we don't have any, you said, the interstitial pressure. We don't have the data on this, and we don't have any data on the blood perfusion, which can be done in the future by people and investigators who use the dynamic MRI studies and so on. The first difference is, and this is the very, very important one, that you have 20 people who died in the control arm than in the combined arm. This is the basis for all interpretations. If you don't have this difference, overall survival cannot be significant. What we analyzed, of course, was the distance events. And now it becomes a little bit tricky, because what we found is that it seems to be, but this is absolutely a hypothesis now, and will be in the discussion of the paper. We based on these tilts, which can be referenced, we look for the dead patients with metastatic disease and for the alive patients with metastatic disease. And now it's very interesting. In the alive population of the hypothermia arm, we have a significant more people who are alive with metastatic disease stable. Whereas in the non-hypothermia arm, if you have a metastasis, you die. So it seems to be that the metastatic events is equal, but the time to live with metastatic disease is much longer in the hypothermia. So this is exactly what people in the melanoma trial with the checkpoint in interesting. So it could be that the whole model is really something like stabilization of abscopal metastasis. But this is complete, interesting, very, this is the fun of research. Yeah? But you have to discuss this and you must be careful. It's a very, very important stem cell question, and also the myeloid derived, because they are, of course, also part in the immune editing of the tumors. We don't know. And I must tell you, we are. Now we speculate in the group, we have two parts. One said the immune deficiency is causing the tumor. The patient has an immune defect and it's causing the tumor. And the other part says, no. The tumor is creating the milieu that all this immune deficiency happened. Of course, the more provocative one is the first one. So people and the general medical oncology and all the researchers believe that the tumor is first, and this is changing the immune system. We are no more sure about this. It could be also that you have an innate immune defect, you create a tumor, and then the tumor makes the immune editing in addition. But it could be that we have some personalized deficiency to create a tumor. And maybe hypothermia is overcoming this.